So now we're ready to look at adaptive defenses and see how they work in fighting off foreign cells or antigens. And so in this video, we're just going to look at an overview of our adaptive defenses, particularly looking at what are our antigens and how does our body recognize self from non-self. And then finally, let's look at lymphocyte development. That is, how do we make T cells and B cells? So let's start with the antigens. The antigen is defined as a substance that can mobilize an adaptive defenses and provoke an immune response. So basically anything that comes into our bodies that our immune system reacts to and has an immune response to. So it has what's called immunogenicity. Its ability to stimulate proliferation of specific lymphocytes and antibodies. It gets an immune response. Our immune system reacts to it. So therefore, we have immunogenicity. Also has reactivity, that is, ability to react with activated lymphocytes or antibodies, again, causing an immune response. Now, antigens can include large foreign polysaccharides, lipids, nucleic acids, proteins, large molecules that the body can, or our immune system can recognize and then mount an immune response to. Now, some molecules are so large, or some antigens are so large and complex that they may actually have several what are called epitopes or antigenic determinants on them. These are just small chemical groups that the antigen binds with some component of the immune system. So here are epitopes on this blue molecule or antigen here. So actually this molecule shows four different epitopes or antigenic determinants. And each one of those is causing immune response because here's a antibody that's reacting with it. Okay. Now, some large polymers, especially plastics, have many repeating units. So there are few or no epitopes. So that way, if there's no epitopes in a plastic, there's no immunogenicity. That is, our immune system will not mount an immune response to those plastics because there's no antigenic determinants anywhere on that plastic. So our immune system can't react with it, therefore no immune response, and our bodies would ignore that plastic. So we take advantage of that in knee replacement or hip replacement surgeries, there's plastics in it, or if you want to do a boob job and get big breasts, your plastic doesn't interfere with that either. Now, to recognize self from non-self, we use the major histocompatibility complexes. These are glycoproteins on the cell membrane. They differ among individuals because of a polymorphism in the gene. That is, lots of different combinations, lots of genes, lots of different combinations that are possible. So everybody pretty much has a different MHC. And only people that have same ones would be identical twins. So the MHCs come in two classes. So first of all, class one. MHC class one are found on all nucleated cells. These are basically the dog tags that we've talked about previously. They're the ones that are going to separate self from non-self. They also hold endogenous proteins, endogenous endo in. So these are proteins that are normally found inside the cell. Now the idea here is you have to imagine one of the roles of the cytotoxic T cells is to go around and survey body cells for abnormal cells. And when it does this, it basically needs to see what's going on inside the cell. Well, there's no little window for the cytotoxic T cell to look into, so it needs some kind of a signal from the cell to say whether it's normal or not normal. So think of this as kind of a flag. If it's a white flag, then it means it's got the MHC class 1 plus normal antigens or normal proteins stuck on that MHC class 1. And so when the cytotoxic T cell comes along and sees this white flag, it knows that everything is normal going on inside that cell. However, if the cell is making, say, viral parts, or it's cancer, so a cancer cell, so it makes weird proteins, it'll stick some of those viral parts or the cancer parts on its MHC class 1. And so like the picture here indicates, that antigenic peptide that's sitting there is from a virus, not from normal cell functioning. So that's like a red flag saying, hey, I'm an abnormal cell, so you better kill me because you don't want this viral infection to spread. Okay. So it's our way for those cytotoxic T cells to say, is this a normal cell or is it an abnormal cell? And therefore, do I have to destroy it? The MHC class twos then are found only on antigen presenting cells. These are typically exogenous antigens. These are antigens that the macrophage or dendritic cell has picked up from the environment by engulfing it, processing it, and then it will stick it on its MHC class 2. And we'll see exactly that process in the next slide. But basically, this means that the MHC class 2 over here has on it a foreign antigen or some antigen, say bacterial or viral or parasite, something anyway that doesn't belong. And so this way, he's going to go, this macrophage is going to act as the scout. He's going to go to the helper T cell and say, hey, look what I found. I engulfed this guy. I want you to see him. Hey, this antigen is dangerous. Let's get rid of it. And then the helper T cell is going to go, oh, wow, okay, let's get rid of it. And he'll activate the helper T cell and boom, you have an immune response. And the immune cell, it'll get rid of the antigens wherever it's found. The steps in which the macrophage or dendritic cells present the antigens shown in this slide. So first, looking at these steps, the first thing that has to happen is the antigen presenting cell has to engulf the antigen. You can see that here. Engulfs, let's say this is a little rod bacteria, and engulfs it and then processes it inside the cell. So now we got a bunch of little pieces of that bacteria. Many of those pieces are going to have some kind of an antigen on it, some kind of protein or polysaccharide or something on it that says, hey, this is not good. We don't want that in there, or we don't want this guy. It's a foreign antigen. So what the macrophage does then is he adds that antigenic determinant or epitope onto its MHC class 2. So here he is making MHC class 2s. He combines his MHC class 2 with an antigen and he puts it or displays that on his cell membrane. And so then the macrophage goes up to a helper T cell and basically acting like the scout, he says, hey, general, to the helper T cell, look what I found. And then the helper T cell in response to that will become activated. So the whole idea of antigen processing cells is to activate T cells. So both macrophages and dendritic cells will activate helper T cells and get them to do their thing, okay? The other thing that antigen processing can do is to stimulate their own activation. And we see this with macrophages and B lymphocytes. So imagine the macrophage here goes up, he activates the helper T cell, and in turn, the helper T cell says, you know, the macrophage is basically like, hey, look what I found, it's bad, we need to get rid of it. The general, the helper T cell, is going, hey, that is really bad, so why don't you go out and do some killing and find some more and get rid of them? And then the macrophage is like, oh, okay, I'll do that. And it runs off, and now it's stimulated and excited about going and finding more of those bacteria and killing them. Now, how do we make these T cells that I've been mentioning? Well, that all starts, as we know, in the red marrow and hematopoietic stem cells. So these stem cells are either going to diverge into lymphocytes. They're going to then from there either remain in the bone marrow and differentiate into B cells here, or they're going to differentiate or leave the bone marrow, go to the thymus and differentiate into T cells. So it's very convenient, B cells for bone marrow, T cells for thymus. So we can remember where they came from. And then they're going to end up, once they go through a little education process, which we'll show next, then they'll migrate in the lymphoid tissues and the spleen and lymph nodes and all over the place to deal with any pathogens. Now, in their schooling in the thymus and the B cells, or bone marrow, they have to obtain immunocompetence so that they obtain receptors force a specific antigen determinant. So remember, we've got, remember I said Navy SEALs, that each population of T cells or B cells are a special troop of Navy SEALs that are good at fighting only one pathogen or one antigen. They're not good at anything else. So one's going to fight ISIS while the other one's going to fight Al-Qaeda. There's no overlapping between them. And so that's the whole idea, is one B cell and T cell population will fight staph, another one's going to fight E. coli, another one's going to fight strep. So we have specific types of antigens that these different populations of T cells and B cells are good at looking for and fighting. Okay, that's the whole idea of specific immune response. That's part of the adaptive immune response. The other thing is that they need to be self-tolerant. These T cells and B cells better know the difference between self and non-self, because if they don't, they'll start attacking their own cells, and that would just not work. So how do they get their education? Well, we know more about what's going on with T cells than we do B cells, so we're just going to stick to T cells right now. So T cells, they're going to go migrate or move into the thymus, and the thymus is their school. This is where they get their education. So a new T cell comes in to the thymus, and he has on what's called a T cell receptor. This T cell receptor you can see here in the drawing, and this T cell receptor has to undergo two tests. One is a positive selection test, the other one's a negative selection test. In the positive selection test, we're testing for how tightly does this T cell receptor bind to MHC class 1s, basically. How tight are we binding to these self MHCs? They have to be able to bind tightly, because if they can't bind to them, they also can't recognize any antigen that's on there, and so that would be bad. So we want really nice tight binding or high affinity for self antigens. So if they do have really high affinity for self antigens, or they bind tightly to those self antigens or those self MHCs, then they pass the test and they live. If they don't, if they have weak binding or no binding at all, then they flunk the test, and the result, it's not, you're kicked out of the program, you die. The thymus will kill it and cause the cell to apoptosis or program cell death, and it's dead. For those cells that pass this test, then they move to the negative test. Now we know they're going to bind well to self antigens, self MHCs. Now we want to see, do they bind tightly to self antigens? That is the little things, the red here, the things that are normally that the thymus produces. I don't want it to react to self antigens. So if it binds really tightly to self antigens, that would be bad, because then it would mount an immune response to ourself, and I don't want that. So this guy didn't pass the test. As a result, he's killed. If he does not bind to the self antigen or has a low affinity for self antigens, then he passes the test and he gets to live, and he graduates from the thymus school of lymphocyte education and gets his degree, and now he's a true T cell doing his job the rest of his life. Okay, so as a positive test and a negative test that have to be passed by these newly formed T cells. Now, the graduation rate in this school is very, very low. Only 2% of the students entering the thymus school of lymphocyte education actually graduate. So you think you guys have it rough. Don't be a T cell. Now, once they graduate, they leave the school, and we call them naive T cells or B cells. Remember, the same thing they think is going on in the bone marrow with B cells, but they're not exactly sure what the tests are. But those cells that graduate from the B school of lymphocyte education or the T school of lymphocyte education get to graduate, and they move on and start, we call them naive cells, because they haven't been exposed to an antigen. They're immunocompetent, that is, they will mount an immune response when exposed to an antigen, they just haven't been exposed yet. So they're fresh out of boot camp, and they haven't entered the war yet. When they do, they start circulating through the lymph, the blood, and any lymphatic secondary organs. So the spleen, the lymph nodes, lymphatic vessels, those types of things. And when they do that, they're more likely to find an antigen, a foreign antigen in those lymphatic vessels, simply because the lymphatic vessels tend to bring all of the or a lot of interstitial fluids and through them, and that draws bacteria up into their vessels, and therefore they can wait right there in the lymph nodes, waiting for this foreign antigen to fly by, and then they can attack it. Once they encounter this antigen in the lymphatic tissue, then they'll become activated and they'll proliferate or multiply, and then they can mount an immune response or strong immune response and get rid of this pathogen. Okay, so they're in and out of circulation constantly, always kind of also hanging out lymph nodes, waiting for some pathogen to swim by to be able to mount an immune response to them. So that kind of gets the overall view of what's going on with the adaptive immune response. So now what we're going to turn to next are the two branches of adaptive immunity. That's humoral or antibody mediated, and then the cell mediated immunity.